Hi, this video explores MiniFit Junior or MiniFit JR connectors and crimps. They have a 4.2mm pitch, which to me is a sweet spot for power connectors for a variety of equipment. I like that the connectors are not crazy tiny, they are finger-sized for a typical amount of power supply conductor connections. And these connectors have been around for decades and are really low cost. To get going with MiniFit JR, of course you need a crimp tool, and then in terms of consumables, the most basic part is the metal crimp socket contact. They're really cheap. I got a strip of 100 of them for £3 from Farnell. Here's a close-up of the basic crimp socket. There are also gold-plated versions, probably better for automotive use for less oxidization or corrosion. This one is gold-plated on the contact portions inside. Here's what the socket looks like when it's been properly crimped. I've bent back the crimp for this photo to show the shape of the metal. The two curves being wedged together is important on crimp connectors because it forms a kind of lock so that when high current passes through, the expansion and contraction of different metals in the crimp and in the conductor wire won't loosen up the crimp. Otherwise, the resistance could increase, causing yet more expansion. Once you have the crimp sockets and a suitable crimp tool, then you're all set for wire-to-board connections. Here are what Molex call receptacles. They attach to the wire end. They've got this thumb latch, which is easy to use given the dimensions of these connectors. This is a single-row receptacle, but dual-row is available too, and it's probably more popular, and there are more number of circuit options, i.e. number of contacts with the dual-row. At the board end, here is a single row MiniFit Junior header. There are options with and without plastic pegs. Some have side flanges instead for self-tapping screws. This one is horizontal mount, but there are vertical versions too. This one has formed contacts, but solid contact versions are possible too for a wider temperature range. Here's a dual row header example. This is available in horizontal and also vertical options too, and with pegs or no pegs, or with self-tapping flanges. Basically, there's a lot of choice. What's really cool is that there are many colour options, and this could be handy for external connections where the user might need the colour coding to reduce the risk of error. As well as wire-to-board connections, you can also do wire-to-wire connections. The crimp pins for this are just as cheap as for the crimp sockets, and they can be crimped with the same tool. This plug is for free wires in, say, a wiring loom. However, there are also panel mount options. The flexibility with MiniFit Junior is excellent. Here's something unusual. It's a blind mating interface. This can be used for building equipment with docking modules, for instance, expansion modules. It's very basic. It's not intended for hot swap, but still it's really nice to see that the very low cost docking capability can be implemented in designs using these connectors. Docking connectors use a concept called gatherability, and the angle wedge achieves the coarse gatherability, and then the rest of the connector shape is used for the fine gatherability. Another thing you can do with the MiniFit Junior ecosystem is creating wiring looms or harnesses with daisy-chained wires. The normal metal crimps support two 22 AWG wires together. With larger 16 AWG crimps, other combinations are possible using thicker conductors, such as two 20 AWG wires. Here's the Molex tool. It's physically slightly smaller than the other crimp tools I have, but at a high level it works just the same, i.e. there's a couple of crimp handles and the two dies that shape the crimp to the correct dimensions. There are two positions for small and large crimps covering 18 to 24 AWG overall. That's a pretty good range, but for 16 AWG, which is required for the highest current capability, a separate tool is required. The basic operation is, of course, to simply squeeze the handles to do the crimp. If you're not familiar with such ratchet tools, The general idea is that the tool locks as you squeeze the handles, so that even if you release the handles, the tool is now engaged in the crimping operation and it won't release the crimp until you fully squeeze the handles right to the end of the handle's fully closed position, and then the tool will release. So to start off, first you have to fully disengage the tool so that the metal dies and the head of the tool are fully separated, and then you're ready to load the crimp. If you ever look around the back of the tool, there's a button there called a locator button, which when pressed will bring forward the loading bay essentially for the crimp. You can see here that as I push the locator button, the crimp loading bays move forward. You have to choose a left or the right die location depending on the wire gauge, 18 AWG on the left or 20 to 24 AWG on the right, and push in the locator button and then slide the crimp in snugly. There's no force involved at this stage, and then the locator button can be released. Next, the handles are squeezed until the ratchet clicks just once, and the crimp is now locked in place so that the wire can now be inserted in there. The wire needs to be stripped in advance and it requires some accuracy, and for these crimps the amount of stripping should be between 3 and 3.3 millimetres. If the wire is stripped correctly, then when it's inserted in the tool, the cut end of the conductor will hit a flat metal stop end on, and so there's no guesswork involved with how deep the wire needs to be pushed into the tool. Just push the wire in fully until it hits the metal end stop. Next, complete the crimping operation by squeezing the handles to continue the ratchet operation all the way until the tool disengages. And as you fully release the handles, the dies will separate. Now you can see that in the two areas of interest, the conductor crimp area and the insulation strain relief area, they've both been formed into their correct final shape. For this particular type of socket, the strain relief gets wrapped around the plastic, whereas some tools form the metal inward to bite against the insulation. MiniFit Junior crimps such as these can be used with two wires simultaneously, which is handy for making chassis, wiring looms or harnesses, and the strain relief will therefore wrap around both the wires. Ratchet operation crimp tools can have slight differences between them, so I'm going to compare a few of them to explain this. The two main differences revolve around how the metal crimp is inserted and positioned and how the wire is positioned. With the Molex tool, as we just saw, the wire is positioned by ensuring that the conductor hits the metal end stop. Here's another ratchet crimp tool. This one is for particular JST connectors and it has a completely different method for both positioning the metal crimp and for positioning the wire. The crimp is loaded into the hinged section, so that's a minor difference. I'm not sure there's any benefit or disadvantage compared to the Molex tool locator button method. However, the bigger difference is with regards to the cable positioning. With this tool, you're actually positioning the end of the insulation, not the end of the conductor. There is a U-shaped slot that allows a conductor to pass through, but the insulation doesn't. The insulation hits against that slot when it's correctly positioned. I actually prefer this method because it means that the amount of conductor that is stripped does not need to be as precise, provided that the conductor end doesn't interfere with the receptacle for the contact when it's inserted in the mating connector. With the Molex tool, if the wire is stripped too much, then the strain relief will not be effective since it won't be around the insulation. With this JST tool, if the wire is stripped too much, then the insulation strain relief is still completely fine, but you run the risk that the conductor may interfere with the receptacle end of the contact if it is excessively stripped. In summary, for these Molex crimp contacts, it's more critical to precisely strip the wire length than with the JST contacts. This means that you're going to need very good wire strippers. If not, you'll need to measure and trim the conductor for every wire that you crimp with the tool. There's this type of wire stripper that has a strip length adjustment, where you can just squeeze the sides of this red piece and it slides in and out, but it's not that accurate and the piece clicks into different positions with not enough granularity. It might provide accuracy to within half a millimetre at best, but the wire needs to be stripped with more accuracy than that it needs to be between 3.0 and 3.3 millimeters for the MiniFit JR crimps. Also, this tool, while it's totally fine for general thin equipment wire, it is useless with the more tougher non-PVC insulation that might be present on, say, 18 to 20 AWG wire. This tool will not work with this wire. This wire stripper would be barely adequate for working with MiniFit JR. This Knipex wire stripper is better by far. There is a depth stop here, and although it still needs quite a bit of care to precisely set between 3 and 3.3 millimeters, you could in theory use a shim to help set it to the correct depth. This tool gives a superb, square, precise cut to the insulation with the required accuracy, and it works with both PVC and with tougher insulation like PTFE, and it never nicks the conductor strands. You can see the quality of the stripped wire is very good, and the length of the insulation removal is repeatable, and in my opinion it's more than accurate to the required specification for the crimps. This tool is Knipex model 121206, but there is another version which is a bit more niche for finer wires. It is model 121202. This model has plastic guides for the finer wires. I think the 121206 is more general purpose, and I'd recommend that for the Molex crimps. Here is a plastic wire guide on the 121202 version. The 121206 version doesn't come with the wire guide. I don't think it needs it for the thicker wires. Apart from that, the operation of these two wire strippers is identical. It's a very good tool. There is also a 12-12-14 version, which would be just as good. It has blades specifically for American wire gauge dimensioned wires from 16 to 26 AWG. These wire strippers are not really that expensive either, occasionally under £100 or $100 if you shop around, and it's been reliable for years. I don't strip wires on a daily basis, but I have tried a wide range of wires with these tools. Here's another type of crimp tool. It's pretty good for non-critical, low-current connections. It's definitely not recommended for anything other than hobbyist use, because it won't crimp to the correct specifications. This tool has a proper ratchet action too. There is no method of precisely locating the crimp, nor locating the wire with this tool. It's all eyeballed. Nevertheless, often you can fairly precisely locate the wire by just feel, because you'll know when the insulation hits the conductor crimp portion as you insert it into the tool. Just like with other ratchet tools, you can squeeze the handles one click or two to hold the crimp in position, and then push the wire in there and feel for when the insulation hits the conductor crimp portion, and then continue squeezing the handles. And it's done. You can see here it's adequate for non-critical use. The entire crimp has a curved shape to it, which of course should not occur, but it's kind of usable. You shouldn't put a lot of current through it because the crimp is not to specification and could have higher resistance or loosen over time, causing failures or fires. Use it just for low current hobby use. One more crimp tool I have here has no ratchet action. This tool is for extremely non-critical use, more suited for crimping data connections in 9-pin serial DB9 connectors, for instance. It has no place in high current connection requirements. Be wary of non-ratchet tools for such use cases. The crimp might occasionally look good, but it will almost certainly not survive a pull test. It can't be used to apply the correct force, and the die shapes are often inaccurate too. I find this tool handy when prototyping with microcontrollers and low-speed data connections. That's about it. As mentioned earlier, MiniFit Junior connectors have been around for a long time. Here's a six-way connector for speakers on a Rockford Fosgate car amp, which is still in serviceable condition after decades of operation. The crimped cable and connector are still functioning after all these years. A lot of computer standards specify the use of MiniFit connectors for internal power supplies. A 24-way connector is very popular. It's used in PCs for ATX motherboards and also finds uses in servers. There is an 8-way MiniFit power connector that is popular on some computer motherboards too. The connectors are also very useful for external power connections whenever one or more DC supply rails are needed. The thumb latch prevents accidental disconnection, unlike the typical round DC barrel connectors. Here a 6-way connector is being used for connecting 12 volts DC at over 9 amps, plus a 54 volt supply rail too. This design is using the right angle header with pegs on the underside, and that's sufficient for external connection use. Many manufacturers, including Molex, supply either cables or complete power supplies with molded grip around the receptacle. You can also get cables with multi-way MiniFit Junior connectors on both ends so that it could be used as a link between equipment, for instance to a control panel or perhaps daisy chaining power. There is a quality crimping handbook downloadable from the Molex website, and it explains how crimps can be tested. In contrast, I did a very primitive test just to provide myself a basic data point. It took an impressive 360 newtons before the wire broke. However, in context, due to the crude setup, there was a twisting force on the connector because of the distance between the holes that had the fishing line and the position of the contact with the wire. The wire remained inside the conductor crimp area though, as can be seen here. The wire break occurred in the bell mouth region, just beyond the crimped portion, and I think that's perhaps possible because everything was not axial, as mentioned. Looking at the other end of the crimp, it's clear no wire strand broke inside the crimp, and the bell mouth would have prevented any strand from being nicked. KiCad already has MiniFit Junior footprints. However, I've made some tweaks and placed 14 of what I think are popular connectors into a separate library that could be used as is or could be modified further. The library's on GitHub, and please share any enhancements you make so that everyone can benefit. I've also taken the CAD models generated by the Molex website and included them so that KiCad can render circuit boards properly with the built-in 3D viewer. This video grew longer than expected. Thank you for watching.